here, in case you're looking. I'm hidden behind these purple shirts, and I'm wearing one, so I am one of them. Glad to see you this morning, and glad you got those fans. Revival is about victory in Jesus day by day. So I want to invite you to stand with me, and let's sing that together this morning. Would you please? Today for the victory that we find in you. In your name I pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Ah! Amen.
Would you join me as we pray? Precious Father, how we thank you that because of Jesus we are redeemed. And we can sing about that victory this morning. And Father, that's why we're here. Just come together, Lord, to worship. We know that wherever we've gathered in your name, Father, you're here. So Father, this morning we just focus on you. We worship you, Father. We praise you for who you are, for what you are in our lives. We thank you, Father, for all that you do for us. Most of all, Father, that wonderful salvation that we enjoy because of Jesus. And I pray for this service, Lord. I pray for Brother Jeremy as he'll come tonight, Brother Larry as he leads our music this week. So let your Holy Spirit empower them both. Let this be a time, Father, when our focus is just totally on you and nothing else. Let all the cares and the worries and bothers of the world just be put aside. Let us get into your word. Let us hear you speak to us through these men. Father, what a wonderful time it is together with fellow believers just to worship you. I pray that everything that's done this morning, everything that's said, even everything that's thought, Lord, will be pleasing to you. And I just simply ask, Father, for this time, that as we leave here today, that we'll be changed, that we'll be more like Jesus. We pray this in his precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so very much, choir.
What a great way. There you are. We're going to have to learn how to adjust all this. Obviously, this is our first service underneath the tent. That's what we're planning to do all week. But let me just tell you, having said that, this is one of the most prayed for services that we've had in a church, as a church in a long time. Now, how can I say that? It's because this is the start. You still got a ring. Are y'all hearing that? It's okay now? Okay. I can just tell you, we have had folks who've been praying, been meeting to pray. How many of you have been praying for this crusade and for God to work in it and move in? I can just tell you, we've been praying for this day. And if you're visiting with us today, understand, we don't believe you're here by chance. We have some folks who've just moved to this neighborhood. We've got some friends that have been invited that this is your first chance to come and join us. We are so glad that you're here. We welcome you. Can you not hear me?
No.
Okay, you can't hear me. Is it because of the fan?
No.
You heard me the first time, then they lost me. Can you find me again? All right. I prefer to be found as opposed to being lost. Okay. All right, can you find me now? Can you hear me now? Okay, good deal. Listen, we're going to have to learn how this works. This is a little bit different. We've not done it quite this way. And as I was saying, if you're visiting with us today, we are so glad that you're here. We want to welcome you. We want you to know that we look forward to how God's going to bless your life, even as you're part of this service, and you have blessed us by being here to be a part of this week. Now, in your bulletin, I'll just tell you there's a little slip that'll tear out, give you some information about our church, but if you'll find that out and place it in the offering plate a little bit later, we'd like to know of your presence today. And then we want to encourage all of you to plan to be here. Beginning tonight, Jeremy Thomas. How many of you remember when Jeremy was here as a student intern over 20 years ago? Several of you do. Now, some of the kids raised their hands. You weren't even alive then. I know that wasn't right. But I can tell you, this church gave him his first opportunity in ministry. Now he's the pastor of First Baptist Branson. God has his hand on his life. He's going to be here tonight. He's going to be sharing. He's preaching three services at First Baptist Branson. As soon as he finishes that last service, he's driving directly here. He feels like he'll be here about 5 o'clock and be ready to preach by 6. So you need to be here and to be a part of that. We look forward to that. And then certainly we've already been blessed with Brother Larry Grayson works with our state convention in the area of worship and music, and I'm so glad he was available and committed to come and be a part of leading the choir and leading our worship. So I just want to say thank you for being here, and I want to pray God's blessing on it. I want to say we have children right now. This is when they want me to dismiss children to children's church. So our younger kids, if y'all will just go to that back table, they're going to be going with you to children's church while we continue in worship. And we've got several coming from different directions to be a part of that. And then, Brother Larry, I'm going to turn it back over to you.
Yes, sir. Thank you. If you are a visitor today, you might have wondered what these were. I think you're probably smart enough that you put it together. But I didn't get to hold mine, so I'm holding it now, all right? When Jesus became my Savior as a 9-year-old. So now you know how old I am, yes? Okay. If some of you on the sides, are you able to hear Brother Mike and to hear me? Are you okay? You need a little bit more? You can hear? All right, as long as you're happy, I'm happy. That's a good thing. So thank you, Mark, for what you shared. Psalm 85 says this. Restore us again, O God of our salvation, and put away your indignation toward us. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger to all generations? Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? So will you, that's our prayer today, will you revive us again, that your people, that we may rejoice in you? Show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Sing with me, would you?
Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
We praise thee, O God.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son.
Continue to sing together. My Jesus, I love thee.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, Savior art thou.
last phrase again. Jesus did. And God, I just pray today you hear our voices in our hearts as we declare our love for you. And God, if there's anything in our hearts and lives today, anything that's preventing revival, God, I just pray that you would speak to us now. We're listening to you with all the love that we have, and we want to please you with all that we are. With our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we want to love you. So God, speak to us, change us, bless us, and thank you again for loving us. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
I was going to say, we've got a tradition where we take time, Brother Larry just left, just to pray. Ask God to prepare our hearts to receive His Word. And so, at this time, let me invite our men, if you want to, let's pray together for this service. Let's pray for God's Spirit to move.
Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you this morning bringing our pastor, Brother Mike. Lord, I pray that you bless every word that he says. I pray that you build a hedge around this tent forced together to stay away. Give Brother Mike your words to say. Give him the message that you have for each and every person in this area. Help us to listen. Help us to learn from your words. But bless our pastor as he brings the word to us this morning. In the name of Jesus, I ask these things. Amen.
Amen.
So,
all right, can you hear me better now? They told me to put the mic closer to my mouth. Okay. All right. We can do that. Obviously, looking forward to what God is going to do this week. Even as we begin this service today, I want to ask you, if someone said, what is the most important part of a worship service, what would you say it is? I mean, if we asked the music guy, he might say, well, it's the music.
That prepares our heart. That gives us an opportunity to express our heart and our praise and our worship to God. Some might say that the most important part, certainly, is prayer. You know, and I appreciate the fact that Brother Larry has led us in prayer, even as he's led us in music. I appreciate the fact that these men, week by week, can realize that tradition in our church has really developed since last year. And the last time we had a tent crusade, that was when the men said, "Brother Mike, can we come and pray over you as you take time to open and share God's word?" And certainly, we understand God works in answer to prayer. Amen?
Amen.
He says, "Call unto me and I will answer you." We can say, well, that's important. And it is. And there are some who would say, well, you know what? When it comes to what's important in a worship service, it's the offering. Because that's when we intentionally recognize that everything we have is from God. It's a way for us to express our submission. It's a way to express our acknowledgement. It's a way for us to express the fact that we want to be good stewards of everything that God has given to us. That's an important part of it. And then, being a preacher, I could say, you know what, the absolute important part is the Word of God, right? I mean, it's preaching and it's teaching. And I can just tell you, there are a lot of places in this world, they don't have a lot of what we consider really important in worship. But you know what, it comes down to the preaching and the proclamation of the truth and the Word of God. And certainly, that's important and highly important. But this morning, I want to suggest to you that if I had to say what is the absolute most important part of a worship service, guess what? It would be the invitation.
Amen.
It would be the invitation. It's when people have an opportunity to respond to what God has said. My mic just went dead on me, and I don't know why.
Use Larry's mic.
Okay. Okay. You think that's what it is? Okay. You know what? If something is going to happen, it's now, right? Well. Go with this right now. Okay, can you find me? Am I there?
Yeah.
Listen, the most important part, as I was saying, was what? The invitation. Have you found me yet? Wes, you need to bring me up. You need to find me, even on this blue mic. All right? The most important part is the invitation, because that's when people take the word that has been sown. That's when people take what God's Spirit has been speaking to them through all the different parts of a worship service, and that's when commitments are made. That's when lives are forever changed and transformed. That's when people get saved, whether it's a young person or whether it's a child or an adult or whoever. That's when people get saved. If I ask you, when did you come to know the Lord? There were many of you that would say, well, that happened at an invitation. It may have been at an old-fashioned revival that you attended. It may have been at a church service, but for many, it was when there was an invitation that was extended and people responded and eternity was changed.
Amen.
Now, I can just say, even as I would say that's the most important part, can I also tell you, sometimes that's the most dangerous part of a service. For some people, that's when they say, well, the invitation's coming. That means it's time for me to pick up my Bible. It's time for me to get ready to go because, hey, the service is over. And that's what it signals. But if you think that's what an invitation is about, you don't understand what it is about. It's about responding to God and His Spirit and what He wants in your life.
Amen.
And even as we begin this series of services together, I want to share with you that one of the things that concerns me, even at invitations, there are so many times that people make superficial commitments.
Right.
They make superficial commitments. They may walk an aisle.
They may take a preacher by the hand, and in doing so, they think, okay, I'm right with God, everything is good, I'm done. Let me tell you, you're not saved by walking an aisle. You're not saved by taking a preacher by the hand. You're saved when you fully commit your life to Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. And that's when you can not just sing, but you can know that you have victory in Jesus Amen. Christ. And this morning, I want you to consider with me a parable, a story of our Lord that I believe warns very clearly against making a superficial commitment to Jesus Christ. It's found in Matthew chapter 22. Matthew chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. And I want you to consider with me this parable today called the parable of the wedding feast. If you would stand with me in honor of God and of His word, I'll read and you follow along in your portion. And again, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. And he sent his servants to call all who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. And again, he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who are invited, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fatted calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. And the king was angry, and he sent his troops to destroy those murderers, and he burned their cities. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you can find.' And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, or bad and good. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came to look at the guests, he saw there was a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and cast him into outer darkness, into the place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth.' And then he says, 'Many are called, but few are chosen.'" Father, again today, we pray you would take this your word and speak it to our heart. As we pray that you would receive glory and honor through your son Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. You can be seated. This morning, I want to share with you three basic truths that come directly, I believe, out of this particular story. And I want to make some application in our lives even today. The first truth is simply this. You have been invited. You have been invited. It talks about a wedding feast. And I can just tell you, God's desire and design is that you and I be there at the wedding of all weddings. And I'm not talking about the wedding of some rock star or some royalty. I'm talking about the wedding supper of the Lord Jesus Christ in heaven. Amen. Now, I can just tell you, sadly, when many people think about what it means to be a Christian, when they think about coming to a worship service, they think more about a funeral than they do a feast. And yet, I can just tell you, the Bible makes it clear. Heaven is not going to be boring. Heaven, heaven is going to be a place of unspeakable joy. I like how the old preacher, R.G. Lee, put it up yesteryear. Heaven is the best place the mind of God can conceive and the hand of God could create.
Amen.
And I can just tell you, if you think this world is a blessing and you can think of the very best in this world, understand this world has been marred by sin. Let me tell you, heaven is the one perfect place, and God desires and invites you and I to be able to be there and to be a part of that. But it's important for us to be certain and sure of our commitment to Jesus Christ. I think there are many who are going to miss out because they only have a superficial commitment to Jesus Christ. When it talks about the wedding supper of the Lamb in the Bible, it talks about how it is going to be a special gathering of all the saints of God and the angels of God together in celebration. I think of what it says, it was in Revelation chapter 19 where it says that I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of mighty peals of thunder crying out, "Hallelujah! The Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exalt and give Him glory. For the marriage supper of the Lamb has come. His bride has made herself ready, and it will be granted to her to clothe herself with a fine linen and bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints." And then it says to the angel, write this, "Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb." And I can just tell you, if you understand the parable, the king in this setting invited everybody to come. But those who were invited failed to come. And they received not one invitation, but two invitations. The first was an initial invitation that says, my son is going to get married, and here is your invitation to be there. Have any of y'all ever gotten a save the date card in the mail? You know, I can just tell you now, before you get married, you send the save the date, which means here's the date, but we've got to work out all the details, and we'll tell you the when and the where and the how and all those kind of things, and lets us know what's coming. Let me tell you, he had sent word and let him know, my son is getting married, get ready to come. And then when everything is ready, I will send. That's the immediate invitation, come on. And he not only says, come on, he says, listen, I've got everything ready. I have sacrificed the fatted calf. And that means calves that were specifically prepared to be slaughtered and butchered and prepared in the best way possible. Everything is ready. It's time for you to come. Historically, that was the invitation to the Jewish nation. And because the Jewish nation failed to receive Jesus the Son when He came, because they rejected that invitation to relationship and to salvation through Jesus Christ, He said, you know what? It's now a time for the Gentiles to come. And it's not that we were God's second choice. He knew it immediately was what was going to happen. In fact, His purpose in saving the Jews was that through them, the world would come to know Him. But when the Jews rejected Him, let me tell you, it threw it open for everybody.
Amen.
That's why you and I today live in the age of the Gentiles. And it's a time when it's wide open for any and all to come. And I like how the king put it. He said, go get the good and the bad. And I don't care who you are. I don't care what you've done, good, bad, ugly. It doesn't matter. You're wanted. You're invited. You're included. And I can just tell you, it's important to know God wants you to be saved. He wants you to be in right relationship with Him. It's not His will that any perish, but that all come to repentance and faith and trust in His Son, Jesus Christ. And so He sends the word. There are some of those that treat the messengers hostile. That's a reference to the fact that there were prophets and different ones that God raised up to go to his people. There, the message was rejected. In fact, some of those were killed. Ultimately, you and I know they nailed Jesus Christ himself to the cross of Christ. Ultimate rejection. Rejection, rejection, rejection. But it opened the way for you and I to be invited to come. And I just want to say, first of all, I read this and I go, you know what? It's a reminder that we're invited to the party. We're included. God wants you there. And then a second truth is this. You need to be properly clothed. In fact, that's what makes people scratch their heads the most. It's like, here is this guy. He's at the wedding. He's at the right place at the right time with the right people. But it says the king begins to look around and he notices in the midst of that crowd, there was a man who did not have on the proper garments. He didn't have wedding garments. And he comes to him and says, you know, how is it that you're here and you're not wearing the wedding garments? Now you and I would go, well, if you invited everybody to come, if I invited you to come to a wedding this afternoon, how many of you would have time to go get your tux? How many of you even have a tuxedo? There might be a few, but most of you don't. Understand, the tradition of the day was this. If you were the king, and understand this was an event, this was a lifetime type event. The king's son was getting married. And normally that would mean this is going to be my heir. One day he's going to take my place. They pull out all the stops. And they invited everybody to come. And if they're inviting poor people and beggars and whoever they can find from all the... Everybody. You bring everybody in. You can... A lot of folks who were there, they couldn't afford clothing. They couldn't afford anything nice. If I invited you to a royal wedding right now, you know, or some kind of special gathering, most of you would say, well, I don't know what I would wear. You know, Kathy and I just went to my nephew's wedding. Can I tell you, we had to go look for the right dress and the right shoes. It's amazing what you get into when you get ready to go to a wedding. Here was the tradition. If you're the king and you invite folks to come, you supply the clothes. So when you got there, you were given clothes to wear. Because nobody... If you're inviting just common people to come to a royal affair, they wouldn't have any clothing. But the king would supply the clothing. When you got there, you would be given the appropriate clothing so that you could wear it, so that you could enjoy the feast, so that you could enjoy the banquet, so that you can enjoy the celebration. Well, let me just tell you, the Bible tells us that Jesus Christ came and died on the cross, was buried and raised from the dead, so that God could provide for us the proper clothing to be able to enter into his heaven.
Amen.
It says in Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 10, I delight in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation and arrayed me in the robes of his righteousness. Now I tell you, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 verse 21, it puts it this way. He who knew no sin became sin for us, for me, that I might become the very righteousness of God. Let me tell you, I don't get into heaven because of who I am or because of what I've done. None of us do. It's because of what God has provided for us through his Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And so it's important to understand that when it comes to getting into heaven, it's not because of how good we are. It's not because of anything that we've done. It's all grace. For by grace you are saved through faith. That not of yourselves. It's not by your effort. And he comes to this guy and he says, why are you not wearing the garments, the proper garments? Now, notice when the king comes and looks at the crowd, he sees this man individually. In the midst of this crowd, if we left in just a few moments, somebody could say, did you see what he was wearing or what she was wearing? And you know what I'd have to tell them? I have not a clue. I can see a crowd of folks, but you know what? Jesus sees each one of you individually. He knows you. He knows your life. He knows what you look like. Not just on the outside, but on the inside. And I can just tell you, this king comes and he sees this man. He's there in the right place at the right time with the right people, but he's not prepared. And so the king says, where's your garments? Why aren't you wearing the garments that were provided? And the tradition would say not only is the king the one who would provide them, but I can just tell you the king would be highly insulted if you didn't wear what he provided for you. And I can just tell you, it's not enough that I know Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sin. I can know that. But have I received it? Have I accepted it? Have I put on what he has provided for me and put faith and trust in him? Let me tell you, you must be properly clothed. Now, when I thought about why did this guy not wear the clothes provided for him, there are two main answers I come up with. I think they're the same kind of answers people give for not putting faith and trust in Jesus Christ. The first might have been something like this. Well, what's wrong with what I look like? You know, I look good. You know, I'm good enough. I can just tell you, there are a lot of folks when it comes to their relationship with God, they think they're good enough on their own. The Bible says that your very best is but filthy rags in the sight of a holy God. And I can just tell you, I can't trust in who I am and what I've done. And yet there are all kinds of people that when you talk to them about their need of Christ, what holds them up is they're holding on to their goodness. You know, I can just tell you, I remember Adrian Rogers talking about how that people in America today are holding on to their self-righteousness and they're like a rooster that's strutting itself straight into the gates of hell. You know what? God has provided what you need. You can't provide it for yourself. It's through Jesus Christ. And then there's a second reason I would say that he might not have put him on, and it's simply this. You know what? I appreciate the gift. I appreciate the garment. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. I just hadn't had time to get it on. I haven't taken time to put it on. I was going to get around to it. I just hadn't done it yet. Can I tell you, all you have to do to miss heaven is nothing. You can know what God has provided for you through His Son, Jesus Christ. And yet, for you to do nothing about what He's done is to reject what He's done and to say no to what He's done. And so I can tell you, here is this man. I like that the king didn't come to him and he wasn't harsh and he says, friend, why aren't you wearing what I've provided for you? Why aren't you wearing the garments? Let me just tell you, you can keep putting it off. And you can put it off and you think, I'm eventually going to get around to that. I know I have never really settled my commitment to Christ. I know I need to get right with God. I'm going to do it one of these days. Let me just tell you, all you have to do to go to hell is nothing. Nothing. This man had done nothing with what was provided. And then notice also the consequences. You need to be aware of the consequences of failing to prepare. And it says, this man was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him hand and foot and cast him into the outer darkness, to the place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. I tell you, that's just a picture of hell. That's a picture of suffering. Let me tell you, Jesus Christ came and died on the cross and shed his blood, was buried and raised from the dead so that no one would ever have to go to hell. In fact, the Bible says hell was created for the devil and his demons. It wasn't ever created for you and I. But it's up to you and I to accept and receive what Jesus Christ has done for us. Now, I begin this service by saying the one dangerous thing, even as we begin a series of revival services and community crusade services, the most dangerous thing is for you to think because you've made some kind of superficial commitment to Christ that you're right with God. Can I tell you today, this church has over 600 members. Do you know why we don't see 600 people at our church or 500 people at our church week by week? It's because there's an awful lot of them, perhaps, who only made superficial commitments. They've never really committed their life to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is not truly Lord in their life. And if you think I'm hard when I say that, let me just tell you what Jesus said. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. You can say the right words. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, enters in, but he who does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Are you concerned week by week, day by day, with doing God's will? That's an evidence that you have truly been saved. That it's not just superficial in your life. Now I said, perhaps the reason they're not here is because they've never really made that commitment. I can just tell you, I am not God. I'm your pastor. I can't see your heart, but God can. And you know where you stand with the Lord today. And maybe there's some of you here today, you need to commit your life to Christ. There's some of you today that need to move beyond just superficial. Well, I prayed a prayer. Have you really committed your life to Jesus as your Lord and Savior? It's only then that you're going to be ready to share in the joy that God has for those who know Him, not just in heaven, but for all eternity. I want to do something maybe just a little bit different, even as we're getting ready for this invitation. Let me just ask you, if you're here in this congregation, and you were baptized and you joined a church at some time in the past, only later to realize that you weren't saved and you needed to trust Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You got saved after you became a member of the church and were baptized. Would you stand up? Go and have a seat. I wanted you to see how easy it is for people to think that if I just join the church, if I just walk the aisle, I'm good. This man was in the right place at the right time with the right people, but he wasn't wearing the right garment. Today, maybe you're here and you need to trust Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe today you know you've been just going through the motions for a long time. Today I want to invite you to commit your life to Christ. Or maybe you're here today. Maybe you're here today and you made a commitment to Christ. But you know what? Today you need to renew that commitment. to Jesus Christ. Maybe today you need to surrender afresh to His Lordship, to His will in your life. Maybe today you need to move forward in publicly professing Christ in baptism or being a part of this church. As God is going to speak to your heart, we're inviting you to come. Not responding to the preacher, but responding to God's Word and God's Spirit as He speaks it to your heart. Let's stand together as we pray. Father God, today, You know us. You know us even better than we know ourselves. And Lord, we pray that You would help us to experience that convicting work of Your Spirit in our life. Father, for those who have never put faith and trust in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, we pray today can be a day of salvation. Father, for others that need to renew a commitment to Christ, let this be that day. God, as we begin this week of services, God, help us move beyond just superficial. Help us to get real. Help us to respond to what You want in our life. Lord, we pray and we ask that help in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask Brother Larry to lead us in our invitation. And then we're going to take time to allow you to respond as God speaks to your heart. And as there's commitments you need to make, we invite you to come. As God speaks, you come. Be seated.